He said, "Man, how do you listen to this stuff? It's really scary." And I said, "You know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends."
He brought to my attention was the regathering of Israel. It's very possible that the end time scenario can be triggered because they are regathered into the land. That's one of the prerequisites for the second coming.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
Good morning. Happy Father's Day.
Same to you.
Thank you. All right, we'll go ahead and get started. We have a couple news headlines to go over today. Not very many. According to the USA Today, Americans' confidence in religion hits a new low, and it was based on some statistical analysis and different things that people are now turning away from religion. And when I read this article, I was pretty excited. I think that's a good thing, right? It's going to be an opportunity for us as Christians to really make sure that as people turn away from religion, to understand the difference between Christianity versus religion. So one of the things that's good is, you know, people are giving up on religion. That's awesome, right? Because we know that religion is dead, empty, not full of the Holy Spirit work. So I think we're going to continue to see a decline, and that's good because we need to start weeding out some of the people who really need to get saved, right? So anyways, that was exciting news. This one's a little bit more interesting. Unless you lived under a rock, you obviously heard about the Pope this week talking about climate change, global warming, whatever you want to call it. And he kind of went on he released a 183-page what's known as an encyclical. Derek, do you know what officially an encyclical is?
From what I understand, it's like the Pope issuing like an official statement to the church. Usually in the past, it was like a letter. But obviously in today's day and age, you can just do it over the internet and stuff. But it's usually addressed to like the bishop and leaders of different parishes. But like I said, nowadays, it just goes to everybody.
Exactly. So it would be kind of like for us, Pastor Block, sending out a book or a letter. It's kind of stating what he views doctrinally about certain issues going on in the world today. He would send it to all the elders of the church, and then the elders would kind of disperse it to the teachers and to the congregation, etc. So it's just kind of like, this is where your leader of your church stands doctrinally. So he kind of is nudging the people, saying, listen, you should believe this too, right? So that's kind of what Pope Francis did. And he went off on Twitter. Literally, he tweeted more than almost 50 times, which the guy usually tweets like once a day. He tweeted 50 times in one day. So he was really trying to get people's attention. You guys got to remember there's 1.2 billion Catholics. And the reason I bring this news article up today is because, remember, we're looking at things through the lens of prophecy. So I'm not up here to debate whether climate change is real, whether we need to be better stewards of the earth, whether so on and so forth. That's not what I'm about. But what I am about is this one of the things that's kind of bringing the whole world together into what we're going to see is what a big word that's thrown around today is called globalization. Notice that Obama was one of the quick ones to retweet this, and he calls the Pope His Holiness, which I kind of slightly take offense to. The Pope is no more holy than you or I in terms of God, in terms of sainthood, as they like to say. They like to have a different definition of saints. We know from the scripture that the saint is any born-again believer of God. But anyways, I want to read a couple of these tweets. Leaving an inhabitable planet to future generations is first and foremost up to us. Now, once again, I'm not here to debate that, you know, global warming, pollution, all that stuff is bad. That's not even an issue. But once again, when I read the Bible, just something for you guys to think about as you're hearing this global warming stuff ramp up, because it's not going to go away. As I read the Bible, I don't see anywhere in Scripture that we have to worry about the world coming to an end due to pollution, due to the oceans rising, due to glaciers melting, etc. I don't see anywhere in Scripture that that is a feasible worry for us. And in fact, if we truly believe in what we call the millennial reign of Christ, we see that Jesus comes back to the earth and kind of sets things right. So once again, with that being said, of course, are we all supposed to be good stewards of the earth? Absolutely. Will we be held accountable to our stewardship of our resources and our stuff? Absolutely. Should we all come together and, you know, really work on, you know, not polluting the earth? Absolutely. But anyways, when the Pope, who is literally, unfortunately, I say unfortunately for us, he is the face of Christianity to the world. Whether we like it or not, the Pope is the face of Christianity. So in the people's minds, there's a possibility that this world, the whole world's going to end because of pollution and because of global warming, which really isn't in the Bible anywhere. So that's a whole nother side issue. Do you have anything to add on that? No? Good. And then the Pope also went off on basically what we would term capitalism. Okay, so kind of free market capitalism. We here in America, we have what we, you know, we believe in people working for their money, for so on and so forth. Long story short, he kind of bashes capitalism. And once again, I'm not going to get into the political issues of this. I just wanted you guys to see kind of some of this stuff. But you'll read that bottom one there. Developed countries ought to help pay this debt by limiting their consumption of non-renewable energy. Long story short, this is what we're kind of seeing, the rhetoric kind of ramping up, is what's known as redistribution of wealth. Long story short, guys, here in America, we're well off, right? Whether we acknowledge it or not, we're rich. A lot of the world sees us as too rich. We need to start taking some of these resources from America and spread it throughout the rest of the world. Now, what you guys have to realize is this is going to directly, this will impact us, okay? This will impact our ways of life. If what these people are trying to ramp through with as far as us cutting down on fossil fuels, us cutting down on carbon emissions, us cutting down and so on and so forth, this will directly influence our lives. It will change a lot. We don't necessarily know exactly what it's going to look like, but they want to make us not as prosperous, and they want to spread that wealth out. Without blanket statementing everything, what I would call a form of socialism, where they believe that the world should just, we should all just kind of get a certain amount of stuff, we should all kind of have the same everything, and a group of people will kind of determine who gets what, etc. And obviously we don't believe in that. So anyways, the reason I'm bringing up some of this stuff is because I just want you guys to see that last one there. Interdependence obliges us to think of one world with a common plan. So like I said, the main reason I'm kind of bringing this out prophetically for us to think about is because we know that in the end times there is going to be some things that bring the entire world together. Is it going to be climate change? Is it going to be global warming? I'm not 100% for sure, but through the lens of prophecy, I'm going to keep an eye on this very steadily. One last thing on it. A lady named Belinda Ryers, who on a geopolitical website I go to, she kind of summarized some of what the Pope was saying. I just wanted you guys to see this, once again, through the lens of prophecy. Our current economic, social, and political systems appear poorly suited for a more integrated and global solutions required to address the challenges of improving livable standards of the world's poor while safeguarding the Earth's life support systems that underpin human life and well-being. So what you guys got to see there, what they're basically saying is the way the world is working right now isn't going to cut it for the future, okay? So people, powers that be, upper big name people are beginning to want to change the way the whole world functions, the way the whole globalization process is going to work. And I kind of highlighted some of these things. The encyclical provides insight into what these paradigm shifts might look like through its reference to the need for an integral ecology. What was really scary about this 183-page thing that the Pope wrote was he kind of wants this paradigm shift. He keeps talking about this paradigm shift among the people. And what he's really trying to connect is this pollution, this overpopulation, this all this stuff to a spiritual aspect. He wants us to all get on board with changing our hearts and our minds. What's scary is when you try to get a paradigm shift without Jesus being the central focus, things can get really scary from there. Because this Pope wants the world to change their view in terms of what's going on here. And he calls it a paradigm shift. Long story short, that's really scary when people start using spiritual terms to try to get the globe to come together without Jesus. That's when things get really scary. Just a heads up. A paradigm shift recognizes that everything is interconnected.
Or not.
Yeah. I'm still recording. No, maybe not. Yeah, I think I'm still recording, right?
I just didn't wonder if it sounds
right. I didn't even think it was supposed to rain today.
Until tonight.
Surprise.
Well, I think it's sunny all day.
Yeah. You guys up there? Okay. So anyways, you guys see some of those words I highlighted, integrated, intertwined, which it highlights are not separate crises, but a console. Long story short, guys, is this going to be one of the things that's possibly used in the near future to kind of start bringing humanity together? I believe so, and we'll keep an eye on it through the prophetic lens. Anyways, so there's just something to kind of keep an eye on. Like I said, it's a big deal. That was a really big deal what happened this week. So we'll pray and we'll get going on our real lesson and get rocking. Father, we just thank you for today, and we thank you for fathers on this day. We know that we can rejoice and be exceedingly glad that our Heavenly Father is perfect. You provide all of our needs, and you're so gracious, merciful, and just amazing, Father, and we thank you for you. We ask that your Holy Spirit join us this morning, Father, as we learn about some of these things coming into the end of this age, and open up our hearts and lives to what you would have us learn today, Father. We love you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Amen. Okay, real quick review. So what we were on last week, just so you know, we're still in the letter of Pergamos, and we're doing the application to the Pergamos church. One of the big things that the Pergamos church failed to do was they took in this doctrine of Balaam, these doctrine of Nicolaitans, which, long story short, they kind of combine the world and spirituality. We kind of see a mishmash of spiritual things and worldly things, and they kind of made it into a pot there. And our goal, scripturally, is we're called to be separate, right? We're called to be clean and separate from this world. So we're really looking at what that means. How do we apply that? How do we do that? And that's what's known as practical sanctification. So daily cleansing ourselves through the Holy Spirit. What does that look like? Practical sanctification is our deliverance from the power of sin. Remember that there's three aspects of sin that we are saved from. We are saved from the penalty of sin when Jesus died on the cross, so we're justified, we're deemed not guilty. But this next step, we're saved from the power of sin, is sanctification. That's what we're looking at. Daily, we are able to overcome idols in our lives. We're able to become clean. We're able to discern properly clean versus unclean because of the Holy Spirit living within us and cleansing us, and that is sanctification. And finally, practical sanctification is where our will meets God's will. Remember I said last week, if you truly want to be sanctified, you have to get out underneath the sun, right? So if we want a suntan, we get underneath the sun. Same thing if we want to be sanctified, we have to get under the sun, S-O-N. Like that? I know. Anyways, so last week we really quickly, this week I was studying, and this from Thessalonians just kind of popped out to me. It's kind of a Holy Spirit bonus for you guys, because it literally sums up everything we've been talking about. For this is the will of God, your sanctification. So we know it's the will of God for us to be sanctified, right? That you should abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you should know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor, not in passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God, that no one should take advantage of and defraud his brother in this matter, because the Lord is the avenger of all such. As we also forewarned you and testified, for God did not call us to uncleanness, but in holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject man, but God, who has also given us the Holy Spirit. So that's God's will for our lives, is to be sanctified. We're going to finish up today what it means to be sanctified, and we're also going to finish up today what's the goal of sanctification. So what's the end game look like? We'll look at that. So real quick review. Last week we kind of looked at that type or that shadow, that the crossing of the River Jordan, the Israelites, when they crossed that River Jordan, that was a picture of sanctification. We know that when when Israel was delivered from Egypt, that was a picture of salvation. They put the blood on the doorposts, they were saved. The Passover, kind of like putting your trust in Jesus. Now they were baptized through the Red Sea. That was kind of a picture of us being born into the body of Christ. But then after that, they had another kind of baptism where they had to cross the Jordan. And we believe that is the picture of us walking the sanctified life. Notice that the conquering the giants can be seen as the overcomer conquering the world, the flesh, and the devil. It's so true to look at in that perspective. I don't know about you guys, but there was a lot of idolatry, a lot of things in my life that looked like giants, right? Like I couldn't overcome this stuff without the Holy Spirit living inside of me. So it's kind of a great analogy. I forgot to tell you guys last week, that story about the conquering of the giants like is like one of my favorite stories. I know I say that a lot, but so much so that I named my boys after Caleb and Joshua. Because if you go back and you read the whole story, remember they sent the spies to go check out the land. And 38 out of the 40 spies came back with a bad report. And they said, listen, the land is great, but we can't go in there because the monsters are too big. The
10 out of 12.
I'm sorry, yeah, 10 out of 12. I don't know where I got 40. 10 out of 12, yeah, because one spy from each tribe. Anyway, but these two guys came back and said, oh, we can take them. You know, let's go get these, let's go slay these giants, right? And that was Caleb and Joshua. That has stuck with me so much so that my two sons are actually named after them. And I know Josiah is Josiah, but Josiah is actually the German variant of Joshua. So me and my wife kind of met in the middle there. Plus, if you read the story of Josiah in the Bible, he was a really good king too. So we kind of had a double meaning there. But there's a little FYI for you. That's how much the conquering of the giants has impacted me. And once again, we see that this is only possible through Jesus/Joshua. And that we saw last week that there was a group of people who didn't cross. They decided to stay on the other side of the Jordan. If we as Christians decide we don't want to walk the sanctified lives, we're going to be the first ones that are defeated. We're going to be the first ones that are overcome by the world, our flesh, and the devil. And I'm not talking about losing your salvation, but I am talking about being overcome, being defeated. Satan, his number one goal right now, see, we believe that when you trust Jesus Christ, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit until the day of the rapture, okay? Now, Satan's number one job is to get us out of the game. His number one job is to get us not being a light, not being salt to the rest of the world. So how is he going to do that? He's going to try to overcome us. He's going to try to get us to fall to our flesh, to this world, or to the devil. If he can get us to fall in one of those categories, then we are no longer going to get people saved, get people sanctified, tell people the good news, etc. So that's his number one goal.
If you guys want a good book on what this kind of looks like, I don't know if you guys have heard of C.S. Lewis. He's one of the great Christian philosophers and thinkers of all time. He wrote a book called The Screwtape Letters. Mm. And that's a great, great book. It's a conversation and correspondence between like a demon general and a lower ranking demon, and these lower ranking demons are assigned to different groups of people, different people, and this higher ranking demon is teaching the lower ranking demon how to keep these people from coming to Christ, but once their client does accept Christ, how to keep them out of the game.
Yep.
And it's a great, it's called the Screwtape Letters. It's a great, you can even go to YouTube and type in Screwtape Letters and listen to the correspondence, like someone's read it, like letters going back and forth, and it's phenomenal insight on how Satan's going to try to keep you out of the game.
Exactly. It's kind of that book is kind of a perfect picture of what me and T. Hood are always talking about, studying enemy game film, studying how your opponent is going to try to defeat you. So anyway, so we look at all this, the crossing of the Jordan. I don't know about you guys, but I want to be one of the Christian groups that actually crosses, right? I want to be walking the sanctified life. So what does that look like? So we're going to real quickly go back. If you guys remember all the way back in Leviticus, God warned those Israelites of how to act before they were going to cross the land. And remember, they actually failed even before they crossed the land. That was where our whole story of Balaam came into place, where they literally were, where God said, guys, don't mix with the people of the land. Don't commit idolatry, don't blah, blah, blah. And of course, they didn't listen to God. They listened to Balaam, and they actually fell for these sins, right? So let's go back to this warning, and let's try not to fall into the sin of Balaam. Let's see exactly what God is telling us to do so we don't fall for those same traps of Balaam. Anyways, you see right there in Leviticus, he says, you shall keep all my statutes and my judgments. basically, we need to keep the written word of God, right? Our number one way to walk in the sanctified life is to know what the Bible says. And we're going to talk more about knowing what the Bible says, especially in light of Pergamos, because Pergamos, how many times does Jesus talk about the sword out of his mouth? That's being the word of God. Like, the word of God is going to be super important for us, and we'll come back to this. But the one I wanted to talk about today is right down here. You shall therefore distinguish between clean animals and unclean. So one of the things that the Israelites in the Old Testament were to do is they were to figure out what was clean versus what was unclean. Because if they even touched some of these things that were unclean, it made them an unclean vessel. Okay. So anyways, do you guys think that today we are called to distinguish between clean and unclean? If you read the New Testament, I would definitely say yes. Ephesians 5, Paul warns, "For you were once in darkness, but now you are the light of the world. Walk as children of the light, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord." Notice that in red. Finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. "And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is." Guys, interestingly, I started doing some word searches here. Finding out, the Greek word for finding out. You know, there's always little treasures when you really go back and study the Greek. Finding out, the Greek word is dokimazo. It's used 28 times in 21 verses, both divisible by 7. Yeah, so we know that's interesting. It means to test, examine, prove, scrutinize, to see whether a thing is genuine or not. The Greek word is actually talking about, so when we refine metal, you burn different metals and you burn out all the impurities and you find out what's good and what's bad. That's kind of what's in view with this Greek word. So for us, it's gonna mean something. We're going to have to kind of test and discern. Some of these things we're going to learn the hard way, but we're going to learn different things in our lives. Some things are good, some things are clean, some things are bad, but we got to filter them out. That's kind of what that Greek word is talking about. What's good, what's bad in our lives, and what do we need to filter out? A key word, a great summary word, is discernment. Guys, there is not a word that I pray more today. When I'm going through my prayer list, there is not a word that I pray more than discernment. Okay? We live in an age of deception. Like, there's literally deception everywhere. There's deception within the church. There's deception out of the church. There's deception everywhere. Discernment is what we need to be praying for each other, because discerning, we can discern what's the will of God. We can discern what the enemy is doing, etc. So that's a key one for us just to really pay attention to. Philippians 1 verse 9, "And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment." There's your word, discernment. "And that you may approve," there's our Greek word, dokimazo, "the things that are excellent." So we can learn the things that are excellent, "that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ," till the rapture. Romans 12 verse 1-2, one of my favorite sets of verses. "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy," there's our one of our key words, "acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove," there's your dokimazo word, what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Okay, so we're going to walk the sanctified life. What is, we got to test and discern, we got to learn what is acceptable to the Lord. What are the things that are excellent? What are the things that are good and acceptable? Okay, we want to be clean, right? A good kind of overall summary statement would be, what are we putting into our brains and into our hearts? Okay, you guys will check out this. Look at that high quality.
It's a caricaturized drawing illustration.
That is some high quality stuff right there. That one took me a while to find on the internet. But anyways, I kind of put this up here as for fun, right? Clean versus unclean. It's easy for us as Christians when you see this stuff that's listed right here, right? Pornography, getting hammered. We see drugs, we see money, we see somebody looking into a crystal ball for the future, bad music. Those things are kind of a given, right? We know that a Christian shouldn't be watching porn. We know that a Christian shouldn't be getting drunk. We know that a Christian shouldn't be abusing drugs, etc., right? So those are kind of easy. Those are the kind of things that, I don't say this to kind of like sweep them under the rug. These are serious things that people deal with. these are giants that we need to conquer through the blood of Christ. If somebody does struggle with some of these, which, by the way, before I got saved, of course I struggled with some of these things, right? So I'm not sweeping them under the rug, but what I am looking at today, man, that's kind of distracting when it's hailing and stuff, isn't it? I guess I didn't even know it was supposed to rain today. Nice. Yeah. Well, okay. We have a bad storm heading our way. Thanks for the heads up. Okay, so well, we'll keep going until we lose power. So anyways, what I want to look at though, guys, is some of the more discerning areas, right? This is where things are going to get kind of interesting. So clean or unclean, I call these the gray areas, okay? By the way, I got to tell you guys, before I even start this, I don't necessarily think that these areas are all gray, okay? I have my opinion. By the way, this is going to be offensive to some of us. Some of the things that we're going to talk about is not a fun conversation to talk about. I do this to kind of illustrate. Is that super distracting for you guys? Are we good? Because what's that? Oh, yeah, it is super loud. Little baby ones? All right. Well,
bear with us.
Yeah, bear with me through here. This one's super important. This one's been on my heart for a long time. But like I said, I don't necessarily believe these areas are gray. I want to bring these up to kind of show you what the internal dialogue should be between ourselves, between deciding what is clean versus what is unclean, okay? And how we do that Christian walk. So like I said, I don't necessarily even think some of these areas are gray areas. I think that they're pretty cut and dry. But that is what the Holy Spirit has told me, and that is what I've discerned through studying the Bible. So the question is, should a follower of Jesus, and then fill in the blank. We know we all have the bracelets, what would Jesus do, right? Should a follower of Jesus practice yoga, okay? And the reason I kind of bring this up is because you could research this, and you can see views build up that both sides are okay for a Christian, right? I could teach you guys that yoga, actually, you're invoking different spirits from the Eastern religion, that there's literally different breathing techniques and practices that cause you to dissociate from your body, where Scripture tells us always to stay in our right mind, right? But then, so that's, I could build up a case for kind of why Christians should stay away from yoga, but then you have the other side where some Christians will say, well, you know, when I'm basically just stretching and I'm going through Scripture in my mind and I'm focusing on Jesus, yeah, and so on and so forth, right? So once again, who's right and who's wrong? Is yoga clean? Is it unclean? I'm not going to tell you what I think, okay? I'm not going to tell you my opinion. If you want to...
Can I tell my opinion?
No.
Okay.
By the way, I found this interesting. I've had this slide planned for almost a month. But today just so happens to be the International Day of Yoga, like literally today. I found that as crazy confirmation. Just a heads up for you guys. Let's keep going. This gets even funner. Question?
If we wanted to know after class.
Sure, yeah, you can ask me my opinion. See, here's what I'm getting at with all this. Is so many Christians are known for what they're against, right? Like, I don't stand for this. This is disgusting. This is unclean, blah, blah, blah. I want to be known for what I am for, right, which is Jesus. And I'll kind of get to where I'm going with that. But yeah, you guys can ask me my opinions on this stuff all you want. But that for the class today, what I'm trying to get at is, remember that Greek word, dokimazo. We're testing things, right? Some of this stuff, you guys got to do homework before you can really think about whether or not this stuff. Like, I would have never even thought yoga was a bad thing, okay? Until you really research the origins of it, what different branches of yoga there are, and what so on and so forth. But anyways, that's just kind of the exercise I'm taking you guys through.
You might have just showed your hand.
Well, I did. I've kind of hinted at it, but yeah. Should a Christian attend Rock Fest? Okay, and by the way, some of this stuff is just random because it's something in my life during this week. You know, we have hundreds of different Christian issues that we have to struggle with all the time, right? So should a Christian go to Rock Fest? My brother-in-law is Moose from 98.9. He's like one of the main dudes. Should a Christian attend Rock Fest, where people are getting hammered, where the music is definitely questionable in some terms? Once again, I could build a case for no, but then again, I could build a case for, well, am I going to go? Am I going to share the gospel of Christ there? Would Jesus go to Rockfest? You have all these different things to weigh in, right? Should a Christian celebrate Halloween? This one's really fun, right? This one's really fun to argue. I mean, I could literally build a case and show you guys the not only the pagan origins of Halloween, but it's an occultic holiday. I could go on and on at building a bad case for it. But then you have the other end of the spectrum where they say, well, the kids are going to go trick-or-treat anyway, so why wouldn't I hand out candy? Why wouldn't I share Jesus with them? Why wouldn't I give them a gospel track, etc.? Clean versus unclean. I'm not going to tell you how I feel, but you decide. Should a Christian drink a beer? Should a Christian drink a beer in their own home, in the privacy of their own home? Should they be able to have a beer out in public? So on and so forth. Once again, you hear different camps say, well, Christians, it should be totally dry, should be no alcohol, etc. Or versus some say, well, I mean, maybe it's okay for a Christian to have a beer every now and again. Once again, that's not for me to tell you what I believe. Support homosexual marriage. We've beat that dead horse. Have tattoos. This one kind of has a personal thing for me. Once again, this is a gray area because, let's be honest, I could build a case for you that right now tattoos are kind of in. They're what the world says, let's do it, right? It's cool, it's trendy, so on and so forth. When I first got saved, I started having T-Hood draw me these tattoos. I was going to get literally my right arm just totally tatted, just from covered. And it was all going to be scriptural, and it was all going to be so on and so forth, right? You can build a case. So, well, I want to witness to people through my body art, through my ink, right? Long story short, through a lot of prayer, through a lot of study in the scriptures, through a lot of where the Holy Spirit was leading me, at that time, he told me no, okay? Do I think all tattoos are a sin? No. Do I think that it's a sin for a Christian to get a tattoo? I'll tell you my hand, no. But for me, the Holy Spirit, for whatever reason I was going to use it for, I was told no. So that's just a kind of way that works out. So should a Christian watch vulgar movies or reality TV? I even put reality TV. Should a Christian even watch reality? Should we even watch something that we know isn't even reality? It's staged. Anyways, and this last one's kind of a, once again, some of the stuff I wrestle with, right? Should a Christian watch MMA? Is it Christianly for us to watch two dudes bash each other's face in? Is that Christian? And if we're on that subject, why would it be any different than us watching football, right? Why would it be any different where we watch a bunch of big, sweaty dudes pound each other out, violent sports, etc.? And once again, I'm not necessarily saying it's right or it's wrong, but what I'm telling you is you could build a case on each side, right? You could build a case on each side. So what does that tell us? That tells us that we need to figure it out through the Holy Spirit, through the Word for ourselves. And that's the process of sanctification. That's the process of testing things through fire. That's the process of kind of seeing the what comes out good, what comes out bad, right? Of the refining the metal. Here's just a real quick entry from Matt Walsh. He's a guy I read on The Blaze. But he said, now, I'm not pretending that I never make bad choices in the media I consume. I have and I do. But I recognize, even in those moments, that entertainment is not nearly a neutral exercise. In every instance, it's going to be a net positive or a net negative for my mental and spiritual welfare. I am inviting these messages, images, and ideas into my mind. I'm doing something that is active and purposeful, and it will either help me or hurt me in the end. So anytime we sit in front of the tube, we should ask, am I progressing or regressing? Is this drawing me to God or away from Him? What am I getting out of this? Just kind of a good little perspective on how we view media. So finally, what am I getting at with all this gray areas is you figure it out for yourself, right? I'll give you guys my opinions if you're interested, but once again, what does the Holy Spirit tell you, right? What does the Holy Spirit through the Scripture tell you? So we also have to discern, what are some of those deceptive things that could be making us unclean in our sanctified walk with Christ, right? And finally, let the Holy Spirit do His job. As I was getting at, so many Christians are known for what they're against, right? I'm against homosexual marriage. I'm against blah, blah, blah. How about instead, if we tell people that I'm for Jesus Christ, if I want to lead this person to Jesus, and then I want to let Jesus and the Holy Spirit and the Bible tell them how to change, right? If we're trying to force a homosexual to accept my view without the Holy Spirit, it's never going to work, right? Same thing with all these Christian gray areas. It's so easy for me to go and bash other Christians and say, oh, you celebrate Halloween, you're disgusting, right? Like, instead of just leading them to Jesus and leading them to do their own homework and leading, and once again, I'm never, if I decide that I'm not going to hand out candy on Halloween, I'm not going to judge another Christian who does. I'm not going to look down on them. I'm not going to say, you guys are less holy than me. You guys are. I'm just doing what I feel is protecting my heart, my family's heart, my kids' hearts for the future. And that's kind of, guys, this is going to be hairy. This is going to be.
And a lot of it just comes down to education.
Yep.
You know, there's some things that I had an opinion on, and then I learned more about Halloween, for instance, and then I'm like, oh, wow. You know, like, the name of the game is deception. Everybody knows what it feels like to be deceived, right? Nobody likes to be tricked. You're a kid, you get tricked. How resentful are you? And then you come into your own as an adult, and you're pretty confident that you can't be deceived anymore. I'm an adult. I've been there, done that. I'm not prone to deception. But you have to understand that Satan is so much more like intelligent than us, crafty than us. He's the craftiest beast in the field. He's craftier than all of us. He's the most intelligent thing that God's ever created. And he will trick adults, you know. And so some of these discernment ministries following them, they get a little bit over the top, you know. And they, you know, like Chuck said, they'll make you think, oh, man, I'm disgusting because I participated in this. But a lot of it is education. And then just praying about it, you know. So that's where I'm at, you know. Some of these things, they're tough. They're tough to handle.
By the way, there's some of these issues I've gone back and forth. I've thought one way, and then I've done more research and I've changed. So anyway, long story short, that's just between us and the Holy Spirit, and you know, that's what kind of the Christian body coming together and hashing these things out. But I want you guys to get is this battle of us being clean versus unclean isn't going to stop, right? Especially in the world we live in today, it's going to get harder and harder, and the battle isn't going to end until the rapture or we die. So we have that to look forward to. See then that you walk circumspectly. I bring it all the way back to this word. One thing I wanted you guys to see, circumspectly means careful. It literally means like unwilling to take risks. Whenever I'm explaining kind of sin, sanctification to somebody, I always ask them, is my goal as a Christian, so let's say there's a line, right? Let's say there's a line on the ground between clean and unclean. My job as a Christian, should I want to get up there and should I want to put my toe right against that line and just get as close as I can without being dirty, right? Is that kind of the right mindset for a Christian, is to get right up to that toe of that line, or should we be trying to back up and stay away from the line as far as we can? That's kind of what I see as circumspectly. We don't just want to tiptoe up to the line, get as close to sinful as we can. We kind of want to have the men attitude that we just want to be careful. We want to stay as far away from becoming unclean as we can. So, finally, I'm going to wrap up this last one here. I got time just to finish it out. This was really cool as I was studying this. So, we need total separation from this world. 1 John 2, which I think that we may be getting to today. Do not love the world or the things in the world, okay? If anyone loves the world and the love of the Father is not in him, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Okay, we know that the world is not talking about human beings in general, right? Right here, according to David Guzik, who's a theologian, he says, it's not talking about the global earth, nor is it the mass of humanity, which God himself loves, and we know that from John 3:16. Instead, the world is a community of sinful humanity that is united in rebellion against God. Okay, so that world system that's going on today, that there's a godless system that is trying to push God out, right? But if we love that aspect, if we love that global community that's against God, then the love of the Father isn't in us. The flesh here, so we're looking at those, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Just so you guys know, kind of get what flesh is. It took me a while to kind of grasp this in my mind, but flesh denotes mere human nature. So if we were all just animals, right? That's your flesh. Like, I got to eat. I got to reproduce. I got to fill in the blank. We're just animals, right? Kind of that secular humanist mindset. That's the flesh. I have an urge. I'm going to gratify it. I'm hungry. I'm going to eat. I'm fill in the blank. Yeah. You guys know what I'm saying. Anyways, so I find it interesting, was John alluding here to the fall in Genesis? So when he was talking about the things of the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, was he making a direct allusion to the fall in Genesis? Because check this out. I'm not going to read the whole thing. But remember the testing, or the fall, when Adam and Eve ate the fruit. So check it out down there in the bottom. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. So check this out. It was good for food. So I'm sure Satan was like, listen, Eve, you're a human. You're meant to eat, right? You got to eat. You got to eat. It was good for food. So that's kind of a lust of the flesh. You're a human. You can eat. Fulfill that, right? It was pleasant to the eyes. So there we see the lust of the eyes. She looked at the fruit. It looked good. It probably was juicy. There was probably some dew hanging off of it. I mean, It probably looked amazing. I forget what they say. Most theologians, they say it was
golden apple things.
I've read different views. Yeah. I can't remember if it was a pomegranate. I've read pomegranate. I've read fig. I've read apple. I forget. Anyways, I bet it was sexy looking though. Number three, and a tree desirable to make one wise. Remember the serpent's lie to her is when she eats this thing, right? She's going to be as God, right? You're going to know the knowledge of good and evil. That's going to make you wise. It's going to make you better, right? That's the pride of life. It's going to make this thing apart from God is going to make you better. That's the pride of life. So guess what? I got some bad news for you guys. Because of failing this test in the garden and giving into the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, we are all doomed forever, and now our nature is prone to falling into these traps. Bummer. Bad news.
It's kind of funny that those things also reflect what Jesus went through in the wilderness. You know, the health and wealth and, you know, look, you need to eat, you need to be healthy, you need to be, you know, turn these stones to bread. Like, that's how he attacks you. He comes through your eyes and your senses and your flesh.
Will you stop stealing my thunder? Why do you do that?
Did I just do that?
Yeah, we were getting ready to cover that. Yeah, that was like my grand finale.
Oh, again. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Get it.
So anyways, don't worry. Someone passed the test, right? Someone overcame these temptations. So the bad news is when Adam and Eve kind of succumbed to these things, and by the way, that's kind of a picture of all the things we're going to struggle with. The world, the flesh, the devil, the pride of life, all this stuff is what we're going to, that's our sin nature, right? Without the Holy Spirit, we can't beat that. But thankfully, somebody did, as I was saying. And once again, I'm not reading this whole story.
We have to work on our communication.
I thought I told you. I remember when I called you, I was like, listen, this is crazy. This lines up. You remember, didn't I? Yeah, like I said, when I was starting.
You've never called me in like
when I was 6 months. No, I texted you guys. It was like a group text. When I was studying these things, I was like, guys, I was like, this kind of matches. And by the way, I'm not saying that I'm probably the first theologian.
You're not.
Yeah. I know. But what I'm telling you is I came to these conclusions on my own. I didn't have to read a commentary. I was just studying. I was like, hey, this all kind of fits. And like I said, that's just the Holy Spirit, bro. Get over it. All right. So Satan, in the testing Jesus in the wilderness, he said, command this stone to become bread, right? If you're the Son of God, command the stone to be bread. Lust of the flesh. Jesus, you're a human. You're hungry right now. Eat, right? Take care of that fleshy desire. Go ahead and eat. Number two, Satan showed him all the kingdoms of this world in a moment of time. It's possible that he went up to Pergamos, that hill on Pergamos, the city, and he somehow supernaturally showed him all the kingdoms of the world. He says, you can have all this stuff if you'll just bow down to me, right? That lust of the eyes, this all could be yours. And finally, my favorite one, the test, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you. He's basically saying, Jesus, you're the Son of God, right? Just go ahead and throw yourself over there. You know your Father's going to take care of you, right? And I love Jesus' response. He said, it has been said, you shall not test the Lord your God. But long story short, what Jesus said is, it's not about me. It's about my Father's will, okay? He's saying, I came for a different purpose. Is Satan right? Would the Father protect him if Jesus threw himself? Absolutely. He's the Son of God, right? But Jesus here is saying, listen, it's not about me. It's about my Father's will. So he's denying that pride of life. So therefore, when we talk about sanctification, having this power to overcome the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, we can only overcome it because Jesus did, right? We can only live perfectly because Jesus did. So finally, there, the second bullet point, you read over and over again, and especially Paul, he talks about us putting on Jesus Christ. Putting on Jesus Christ. That's sanctification. When we know that we can't clean ourselves up, we put our focus on Jesus, through the idolatry, or through the question I have, should I drink a beer? Should I blah, 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 and see what God leads you to. And finally, what is the final goal of practical sanctification? What is the final goal? Romans 8:28, it's all one of our favorite verses, right? And we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined, and this is interesting, to be conformed to the image of his son. So what is our destiny? What is the goal of sanctification? Every day it's to become more Christ-like. And I know that's not always the case. As a Christian, when we look back, generally a good rule, Paul tells us to test ourselves to see if we're in the faith. I don't necessarily think that he's saying test yourself to see if you're saved, but I think what he's saying is test yourself. At the end of a year, really go back on your spiritual journey. Am I growing to be more like Christ, or am I growing to be more like the old self? Am I becoming more sanctified, or am I maybe becoming less sanctified, etc.? But our goal in sanctification is to be like Jesus. By the end of our Christian journey, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, it should be more where we exude Jesus.
Is it James that says, count it all joy?
Mm-hmm. Suffering?
So all suffering and testing and
Peter. Peter and James both say it.
And the chastening. So when he's saying to be conformed, that comes along with an actual act of God working in your life and testing. Have you ever heard the expression? We talked about this in the Brandon's Wednesday night class. Don't pray for patience, because God will put you through trials to make you more patient. Like, y'all heard that before?
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's a lot that goes along with that. Like, you know, the reason a Christian will endure pain and suffering, he's training you. He's conforming you to the image of Christ, and the only way that you're going to do that is if you're put through trial and given opportunity to overcome. You know, it's like when you're working out and you tear down your muscle, you're tearing down your muscle to build it back up, and that's what God is doing in this process. So that's why they say count it all joy. You lose a loved one, count it all joy. You lose, you know, you get in a car accident, count it all joy. It's all these things are working together for good. It says we know that he's got all these puzzle pieces under control, and he's working them all together for good. You know, I've always heard the analogy, this verse, Romans 8:28, is kind of like biscuits. If you take all the ingredients of biscuits, you won't want to eat them by themselves. You don't want to eat salt by itself. You don't want to eat, you know, flour by itself. All of the ingredients of biscuits are terrible by themselves, but you work them all together, they make biscuits. You know, so that's good, right? And that's how this verse kind of works out.
Amen. So that kind of concludes that, and then we'll get to beware false teachers within the church next week. Ooh, that'll be fun, right? I promise you guys, I have about 7 more of these, and we're going to fly through them. We're going to get done with Pergamos application next week. Then I have a little bit of bonus things, and then we'll start Thyatira. So we're almost through Pergamos, but I hope you guys see why it's really important, why I wanted to take a little extra time, because once again, Pergamos is really important for us to study because they joined the world. They mishmashed things of the world, and our goal is to separate from that. So I want to take a little extra time in this application to really grasp sanctification. Do you guys feel a little bit better about grasping sanctification, what it means to be clean, what it means to get rid of idolatry in your lives? Because if so, then it was worth it. Okay, well, we'll pray and we'll get out of here. We're late.
Thank you, Father, for this day. Thank you that your son wrote this letter to the Church of Pergamos. It's been a great way for us to learn about sanctification, separation from the world. Let us consider some of the examples that Chuck was talking about gray areas, and you know, we all have our different gray areas in our lives. Just let us do what the scriptures say, and you know, test these, the word dokimazo, you know, prove these things. You know, and if you tell us to partake in them, let us do it for the right reason, or if you want us to sustain from any of that stuff, just please guide us. And Father, thank you for the technology being able to stay together as much as it did, considering the weather. And we just pray that everybody can make it out safe next week. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.